Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Vinyl Lounge and Golden Discs here in the heart of Cork City in Patrick Street for a little affair we're calling Red Talks Records with Mr. Tommy Tiernan. How are you, Tommy? How's it going? The Under the Influence DVD is last year's show? Is that how it works?
Well, I tour each show for about two and a half years. And even the very last time you perform it, you're still rehearsing it. You're still adding stories, taking stuff out. It's a constant work in progress. So then you end. I mean, I don't really know how much attention people pay to the name of the show. Anyway, it's just there's your man again. So the new one is called Paddy Crazy Horse, which is the name that I wanted to give one of the kids. But my wife wouldn't let me. So I'll be touring. I started touring that show in September, and I'll be touring that now until probably till 2021. But always working on it, always adding stories, you know. And I used to mainly tour around Ireland, but recently I was offered a tour of just yesterday. I was offered a tour of Asia. Right now, you know, what the hell? Anyway, so this fella just sent in and said, we can do 6 gigs. He said, I can give you $45,000. Now that's like about €8. So 6 gigs for €45,000. And you're thinking that's like a great night on a winning streak. Do you know what I mean? I'll do that. So the gigs are like Tokyo, Hong Kong, Bangkok, Saigon, Saipan, and some other place. And we say to you, he says to me, we can offer you first class flights and accommodation in 7-star hotels. And you're reading this and you're getting very excited.
Was there a Prince of Nigeria signature
no,
at the end of this?
But then you kind of think about it and go, this sounds a little bit too good to be true, you know? So stuff like that comes in. And so I know with this tour that I'm hoping to do an American tour with this show. I know I'm doing an English tour next year. I'd love to do another European tour. I'd love to tour Africa. I just don't want to be at home, basically. So all these things come in, and the challenging thing and the interesting thing is, okay, not in terms of career advancement, because that really doesn't interest me. What interests me is where I spend time. And I get very excited about touring Ireland. And I know it's, it probably sounds quite unglamorous, but like I'm in Ballybunion on Saturday, and I'm tremendously excited about that.
Well, it's like you're the travelling filly of old from town to village, and because you do a lot of little small
venues. I'm like a Heineken rep. I'm just kind of going from... But I love that. And the international touring doesn't really interest me as much. I don't want to be away from home. But still, the idea of doing a gig in Saigon, I mean, that's an exciting idea. So I kind of play around with stuff like that.
Or even Saipan. Are they aware of how well-known that little island somewhere off Japan or out in that part of the world is over here?
Yeah, I can't imagine that. The trials and tribulations of the Irish soccer team had much of a presence in the, is it Indonesia, wherever the Indonesian psyche, I don't know. Where's Saipan? Korea? Is it Korea?
I think it's south of Japan, isn't
it? Yeah, nobody knows. Look, nobody knows where Saipan is, just that it happened.
A plane will get you there, that's the important thing. So, but look, just the DVD Under the Influence is a part of the reason for us getting you here today to promote that. Just to talk on that for a moment, the title of it, I know you're saying people don't worry about the title of the shows, but where does the title for that one come from?
Well, the Under the Influence is, when I walk out on stage, I'm always under the influence of something or somebody. I managed to meet Bob Dylan's manager Bob Dylan was doing a gig in the Three Arena. And his manager said to me, oh, at the moment, he's channeling Frank Sinatra. So Dylan was on stage kind of imagining he was Frank Sinatra. The manager told me in the tour before that he was channeling Charlie Chaplin. So whenever you walk out on stage, you're under the influence of something. I would sometimes be under the influence of Billy Connolly, sometimes Bill Hicks. Sometimes I'd be under the influence of, you know, harp, lager sometimes. So you're always, it's impossible not to be, have some kind of ghost work on your imagination in terms of helping you perform. So it's just about choosing the right one, you know.
Is that something that develops over your career? Because, you know, in the sense that, like, let's say a Dylan who's had such a lengthy career as well, like, yeah, maybe he needs that to keep him fresh.
No, from the very beginning, the very first gig I ever did, I was pretending I was Dennis Leary. Dennis Leary is an American comic who came out with this show called No Cure for Cancer in the late 1980s, maybe early 1990s. It's very funny. It's a lot like Bill Hicks's type of stuff, but not as he was a lot more, achieved a lot more mainstream success than Bill Hicks did. So I remember going, I saw a DVD of Bill Hicks and he was wearing a leather jacket and drinking a bottle of beer. And my first ever gig, that's what I did. I wasn't wearing anything else, a pair of sandals. But so you always have these things going on inside you, you know. Everybody on stage is trying to be themselves while at the same time pretending to be somebody else. And that's just the process of it. That's the kind of, sometimes I feel like, you know, I know I'm in danger on stage when I start acting like Bono. I know that's, I'm in trouble then. But so was he. So
and he's on stage pretending to be Tommy Tiernan.
So yeah, you're always, so the name of the show was just a kind of a nod to that for myself, really.
Well, in thinking about, you know, I'm not sure, have you ever been asked to have a think through music and what ones would you choose to be the, you know, not the five most significant, but the five that you'd bring out and yeah, play for people? Did it bring, you know, because I was thinking, what would I do if, and it's probably eras, you know, you probably look at school and then you might go college. And was there an album amongst the choices that fits to that Dennis Leary time with the leather jacket and the bottle of beer?
Not really. I'll tell you what there is. We'll start with the Dylan one, Highway 61 Revisited. And what blew me away about this album are the words. You know, can we play a bit of it now? Just play, I can't remember what songs I chose.
I do, I think. Give us a look there.
But if you kick off with one of them there.
It takes a lot to laugh, it takes a train to cry, was that one?
Yeah, and how does that start?
Oh, God knows.
We might give it a lash and just play it for a minute and I'll tell you why I chose it. Ah. Oh. It's his husky voice in this one.
Well, I ride on a mill train, babe. Came by a thrill.
That's a perfect song for driving from Naas to Clonakilty. That is just... Dylan blew me away with the words, you know, and words that needn't necessarily make a fierce amount of sense, but in that album especially, that's the same album that he has Queen Jane, Like a Rolling Stone, Desolation Row. These are phenomenal pieces of music. And I started getting into Dylan
1965, and look how young he is as well.
Incredible. I started getting into him when I was about 16, and the words just... when you say, you know, I don't know what kind of an influence he would have had on me in terms of... When you start listening to Dylan, you go to school, and the school is the school of language. And you see how a highly creative person uses words, and I'm still going to school with Bob Dylan. You know, last night in the car, I was driving down from Limerick, and I was listening to two or three of his songs, you know, and it's just, you learn about language with Bob Dylan, and that's why he wouldn't be as open-hearted as someone like Leonard Cohen, but he's, like, there's great venom, and there's great distance. You're never really sure who Bob Dylan is when he's talking to you. You're sure of Leonard Cohen because he's very honest, but Dylan's stuff is a lot more masks. But you'd hope that you're kind of schooled in how to communicate and how to play with language and stuff that needn't necessarily make sense, but is still enjoyable to listen to, you know?
And I guess for yourself, you're someone who uses words and shapes and molds
totally.
Them and delivers them out and ups the pitch and downs the rhythm.
Yeah.
And you have to find the rhythm of your audience.
Yeah. You'd never hit the fluency and the magic of what Bob Dylan does, but you'd it'd be in your soul when you're talking, for sure, you know. And the fact that he's still touring, you know, it was very very sad recently when I learned that Billy Connolly has stopped, you know, and that to me seems like the end of an era. And that presence is no longer with us, you know, performance-wise. And I feel kind of sad because of that. But Dylan is still out there. Dylan is 76, 77 years of age, and he's still doing gig after gig after gig. He's the same age as my dad, you know. I think he might be my dad. I think that a man and a woman, but I think we have more than one father. You know, I think we have biological parents. And the act of being a biological father is actually quite, it's not much to it, really. You know, it's an emission. To become a father, you don't need, it's quite a pleasurable experience. It's not, you know, there's not a lot to it. But as we're growing up, I think we choose role models. And we don't have to know them. We can just listen to their music, who act as kind of surrogate parents. You know, and Bob Dylan is definitely one of my fathers. Totally, you know. But we all have that, you know,
I presume people often use the word heroes. Maybe that's part of what they mean.
Well, hero, I'd never put pressure on someone like that because no one can live up to heroic.
But maybe
status.
That's what people mean when they're describing someone as their hero.
Yeah, right? I'd never call someone a hero, really. I mean, Mother Teresa, she's... wouldn't have released a fierce amount of albums now, but... people might call her a hero. That's their business. Like, but in terms of, I wouldn't burden most people with the weight of being a hero because no one can live up to that. You know, nobody. I'm sure Mother Teresa had her dark days. You know,
I think people wrote about Mother Teresa's.
But Bob Dylan for me was definitely. And continues to be a huge influence on me.
I know it's 1965, so it's the mid 60s, and you mentioned just as a wordsmith and as you. But I mean, the notes are worth reading. I think alone.
Yeah.
You know, you are right, John Cohen. Quasimodo was right. Mozart was right. I cannot say the word "I" anymore. When I speak this word "I," it's as if I'm speaking of somebody's eye, and so on and so forth.
Yeah. He's wild, like.
Yes.
Drug fueled. Wild.
Would you like to choose another one from it?
I can't remember what ones that I...
Was it Highway... Was it...
No, it wasn't. It was... I think it was from a Buick 6.
And which is
the song after It Takes a Lot to Laugh, Takes a Train to Cry.
Okay, from a Buick 6. Let's do that.
And this is a faster one than the last one, I think, if I remember rightly. Again, with that, I mean, you have no idea what the fuck is he actually talking about. But there's something about it. There's something about the tone. There's something about the rhythm. There's something about the kind of the smoky nature of his voice that he creates a mood. And Dylan, when he's writing a song, it never seems to proceed in a logical fashion. He's almost like somebody who's describing an object from 8 different points of view. Or he's like he's telling you a cinematic story from the perspective of different characters in the movie. It's not just I went here and I did that. Now, he did write songs like that back when he was starting off folk songs, but the majority of his rock and roll stuff is so multi-dimensional, you know? And that's not something that really works. I mean, in stand-up, when I get up on stage, I'm not me, you know? I often wonder... There's a friendliness to some sort of comedy, you know. There's a charm to some sort of comedy. There's a comedy which tries to make everybody its friend. There's another type of comedy which you can't really trust, which kind of undermines everything. There's a price to be paid for doing that type of comedy because you get into trouble a lot. But Dylan, to me, seems to sometimes embody that kind of trickster figure. You know, can you trust this guy? But he's phenomenal. I mean, I think every era has huge cultural presences. And just because Dylan is alive now and working and sometimes doesn't release albums that everybody likes doesn't mean that he won't, in time to come, be measured with alongside people like, you know, T.S. Eliot, Mozart, William Butler Yeats. He is in his own genre. I'm not saying he's good a poet of those people, but in his genre, he is so unbelievably and strategically creative. He's wild, like, you know.
So often people in their lives have musical mentors or an older brother or someone who passes the albums down. So at 16, where or what brings you to Bob Dylan and what else was sort of around you musically?
Well, I was in boarding school at the time, and I just remember, so vinyl back in those days was still, some people had tapes, but vinyl was still current. And I seen this guy walking down the corridor, and he was carrying what I later found out to be his brother's Bob Dylan albums. He'd stolen them from the house and brought them to the boarding school. And one of the priests, we were allowed into the priest's bedrooms when we were in boarding school. And it sounds, people start tittering, but I swear to God, nothing ever happened. It was just, you were allowed to go into the priest's bedroom, and the priest's bed was there, and his desk was there, and one of the priests had a record player. And he would allow us to come into his bedroom to play albums. And I saw this guy walking down the corridor, and the album he had under his sleeve was Infidels by Bob Dylan. I remember seeing it, and I remember this thought passing through my head: I wonder, will I ever get into him? You know, and I remember the first Bob Dylan song I ever listened to was Joker Man from the album Infidels. So that was the first time I ever came across him. Up until that point, I'd been into Christa Berg. Which is a kind of storytelling, you know, there's a Spanish train that runs between Guadalquivir and Old Seville and Patricia the Stripper and all those songs, which is kind of like storytelling for children or, you know, cam people. But for 12 and 13-year-olds, I love that stuff. And then I got into A Flock of Seagulls. I kind of wanted to choose a band that nobody else in Navan was into, and nobody else was into A Flock of Seagulls. So I got into them. Telecommunication. But Dylan was the first, the one that has stayed with me the longest. The other people that I was into at that age, when I listen to them now, it's nostalgic. But for Bob Dylan, he's still with me.
Still fresh. And did that bring you towards any of the other selections, if you know what I mean?
Not really. I mean, there's Tom Waits, you know, who, again, these songs make me cry, actually. The two Tom Waits songs I chose were Jersey Girl and On the Nickel. On the Nickel is just a very, very moving song about one of the lines in it is, here's to all the little boys who never comb their hair. And that's just a magnificent anthem for young fellas who don't make it, you know. And I was a young fella who had curly hair that I never brushed. Now, I have it easy, you know, in the sense that I have a fine career and I'm able to earn as much money as I need. But this song, On the Nickel, is just, it's heartbreaking, actually. I feel it's emotional, you know. The other song I chose from that album is Jersey Girl, which is a song about having a woman in your life that makes everything okay. That amongst all the trouble that you might have between your ears, that there's a girl who can handle that and makes you feel okay. So they're quite emotional songs, those two. And I find that I do most of my crying in the car on my own. So I might have a long drive, say, from Navan to Donegal or something. And if I time it right, if I just get the mood and the music right, I'll be weeping driving through Mayo. But it's always with music. It's always, I need someone to help me cry. And Tom Waits does that.
And sometimes you need a bit of time. We're in a world of so many distractions and so many things that when you're driving and you are in your thoughts and you're listening to music and it is evocative and nostalgic. And I hear you. I've had an old cry of the loss of my dad on a drive myself.
It's where men do most of their
crying in the car. Yeah. Maybe there's a TV show in it. Will we play one and see if we can get anybody here to cry today?
Yeah, so... On the Nickel or Jersey Girl, they're the two that I am.
Because I know for me, with Tom Waits, it's hard to look past Closing Time as the kind of album. I don't really know this one, so maybe this is a new discovery from right here. This is it called Heart Attack and Vine? Oh,
yeah.
Oh, and there's is this the download link? Is that what this is? Yes. Oh, take the photo, lads. It's great that vinyl's kind of come back, hasn't it?
Yeah, it's harder to listen to, especially when you're driving, but... the new BMW 7 Series, instead of a CD slot, is a vinyl tray that you just...
I have Jersey Girl here. What was the other one you said?
On the Nickel.
Will we...
Try On the Nickel, yeah. It'll blow me away. New BMW is great. It also has an espresso machine.
Sticks and stones will break my bones. Always will be true.
Now,
what did you think of that?
It's phenomenal, like, you know, and it's as well to stop it there because I would be crying by the end of it. So, beautiful, beautiful. On the Nickel, I guess, is a synonym for being a rent boy. You know, and actually, I have a. When I first came to Cork back in the late 1980s, moved down here in 1988, and I was a virgin. I was 18 years of age and a virgin, and very poor. I was on the dole, and the guy that I was living with, his uncle used to live in Dubai, or somewhere in the Middle East. Where drink is, it was actually in the United Arab Emirates where drink is illegal. So they'd make their own drink. And the drink that they made was then called Jeddah Gin. And the friend of mine got the recipe for it. And we made like a 44-gallon drum of this Jeddah Gin, like homemade green diesel, basically what it was. He went back to Navan one weekend, and it was just me and this vat of homemade drink. So I got really drunk on it, and I decided that I'd go down to the bus station, find a prostitute, and lose my virginity. Now, I had no money, right? But what we used to buy for food, we used to buy these like £3 packs of Flavin's Progress Oatlets. And my ambition was, I would say, in my imagination, I'm gonna find a prostitute, and I'll go up to her and say, look, will you have sex with me? I'm a virgin. I don't have very much money, but we have a load of porridge back in the house if you're hungry. And I didn't see any prostitutes, but I saw some boys standing on the corner. So that just reminded me, that listening to that song just reminded me of those young fellas that I saw standing around the bus station in Cork on the Nickel. Way back in the late 1980s. So
I didn't know you lived here for a period. What brought you here?
I lived, nothing really. The dole, I suppose, brought me here.
And out in Navan for a while?
Out in Navan for a while, and I got a job in the Simon community, being a kind of volunteer there. I was living in a place called Villa Maria on Wellington Bridge, just the far side of the Mardyke, and I was here for 6 or 7 months. And I loved it. I've always loved coming to Cork. You know, I've been coming here for 25 years doing gigs. I love it.
I'm a blow-in from Dundalk myself. I came down in 91 to UCC and never left.
Yeah, it's a great place.
Contrasting Cork then to Dundalk then, no contest.
I used to take a fierce amount of drink and drugs when I came here, you know, and I collapsed on the street one time from just a night of excess. And I was brought to a hospital, and I came to consciousness in the hospital. And I had a gig that night in City Limits, and I just came to consciousness, and there was all types of drips and wires hanging out of me. And I just came to consciousness, and there was this doctor sitting, an Indian doctor, who was sitting at the foot of the bed, and I kind of came to consciousness. And he says to me, have you taken any drugs? And I says, no, I have not, no. And I fell back to sleep, and I woke up, and he wasn't there. So I just unplugged myself from all the drips and walked down to Coburg Street and did the gig. In whatever kind of state I was in, I've lots of great memories as well, but no, yeah, great memories.
Well, sometimes of an evening when I'm interviewing someone over some achievement that they've had, you know, I'll say, you know, you've done yourself proud, you've done your family proud, you've done your country proud, but more importantly, you've done Cork proud, which is a hat tip to you and your...
More importantly, I'm from Cork. Totally.
I'm the president of Ireland, but more importantly, will we do Jersey Girl? Or
sure,
or do we...
I mean, it's in the same vein as, okay. As that, except it's a tribute to... jeez, I'll start crying now again.
Well, that's fantastic.
Oh, it's phenomenal, yeah. And for those of us who are in relationships, you know, relationships have many, many different personalities. You know, and sometimes you're in trouble and sometimes you're in grace and sometimes you're in love and sometimes you're in habit and sometimes things don't go well and sometimes they do. A song like that is just a great testament to those times when you're able and want to look after one another, you know, and it's just... I'm very fortunate to have that in my life, to have a woman like that that I can fall into and everything will be all right, you know. So it's, another one for crying on the drive, that one.
When I first heard Tom Waits, I couldn't believe that you were allowed to sing like that. I mean, it's such a rough, gruff voice.
Oh,
and
yeah.
And yet around it, I'm noticing
great
in this...
Great melody.
The orchestration, and there's such a softness and sensitivity, and then this, yeah. There's a nice kind of a light and dark
but
shade
like,
to that.
Like Dylan as well, he's kind of an unorthodox voice.
Yes.
But that's what, that's part of the charm, you know?
Well, we've gone from 65 to 1980, but in terms of music choices, they were around the same era
sure,
for you.
Sure,
are
yeah.
we still in the kind of teenage years or early college years or anything like that?
Again, to be honest with you, music doesn't move like that for me.
Mm-hmm.
We have a Pogues album here. And I suppose there's a... you could say there's a vague link between Dylan, Tom Waits, and Shane McGowan, in the sense, first of all, three men, but they're also the kind of outsiders in a way, you know, the kind of maybe not punk sensibility, but they're kind of literate outlaws. There's nobody like McGowan, do you know? I mean, The two songs I chose here aren't the normal ones either. Sally MacLennan and I'm a Man You Don't Meet Every Day. When you listen to his writing, it's unusual. Their songs are almost like short stories. You know, he's probably more in common with great kind of short story writers in Ireland than he has with other songwriters. Phenomenal packing of information, incident, emotion, tone, outlook in his music. I mean, you know, I met him a few times. I did a photo shoot with him once, myself, Sinead O'Connor, and Shane McGowan in the one photograph. and he walked into the room like a puppet. Do you know, he looked like a man who was riding an invisible bicycle with his with his arms on the handlebars as well. And it was a pleasure to meet him. I mean, my meeting him made no impact on him. Do you know, he was just like, I said to him, he's from Pocoon, which is the name of a great Spike Milligan novel, but he says, he's from Pocoon in County Tipperary. And I said to him that I was there. You know, I said, oh, I was in your hometown last week. And he said to me, that's your fucking problem. So, but again, and I suppose the links between the three of these guys so far is the writing, you know. Phenomenal.
And unusual vocal deliveries as well.
Unusual vocal,
Will we have a...
Not people you would imagine who ever went to singing school. You know,
what are we at?
Well,
here?
Choose
what?
One of them is slow 85. And one of them is fast. So, I'm a Man You Don't Meet Every Day is slow, and Sally MacLennan is fast. So
well, let's go with
choose.
Sally.
Sally McLennan, sure, yeah. Again, just the amount of... The songwriting is so dense in this, like, so...
A raucous track.
Oh, just fucking brilliant. In the words of Dana. yeah, amazing. Just amazing. You know, great. I was talking to a man recently who fell overboard on a boat, you know, and he thought he was going to die. He didn't, obviously, that's why he was able to tell me the story. But... He was in the water and he thought that his time was up, and he had this, his life didn't flash before his eyes, but he had this kind of memory or this kind of overview of his life. And he said he was really glad for all the nights that he went on the beer. He was glad for the times that he'd extended himself that way and allowed himself to get drunk. Now, he didn't live there. He wasn't getting drunk every night, but he said he was able to look back in his life and be happy that he'd gotten really, really drunk a good few times. And there's a little echo of that in the story of that song as well. Two fellas on the beer, one of them is about to hit the road. And yeah, so I think that kind of great Irish attitude to drink that we have, and we shouldn't let drink be demonized. I don't think it is, really. And we obviously need to mind ourselves, but getting drunk, getting wickedly, wildly, messily drunk every now and again, it's kind of all right. You know, it's getting, you wouldn't recommend it more than 4 or 5 times a year. That might be a lot as well. Maybe twice a year. So you just get absolutely destroyed. And no harm in it. Like, you need a few days off work after it, and you might need the help of a kindly woman or a psychiatric nurse, but no harm in it. And that song is a great... Paying. Is that the right, how you pronounce it, to that, you know?
I'm a man you don't meet every day?
Yeah.
Not a statement, the name of the song.
Again, this is just... all the songs are quite slow and emotional today. That was just what happened when I was choosing them.
Well, what was going through your... Like, what were you... Were you
I just... I love his songwriting, and I just went through the album, and I think it's the same album. Is Fairy Tale on it? And stuff like that. And I didn't want to be picking obvious ones.
No, Fairy Tale's not obvious. There's a few obvious. A Pair of Brown Eyes.
Yeah, Pair of Brown Eyes.
Dirty Old Town.
Rainy Night in Soho. They're kind of obvious ones. Whereas I'm a Man You Don't Meet Every Day. Kirsty MacColl sings on it as well. Her voice is always lovely to hear. Mm-hmm. And again, it's the quality of the songwriting. And the
but just generally, when you were going about thinking in general of all of these things, was there a way you did it, or was there a...
Just stuff that I wanted to hear. Maybe stuff that I hadn't listened to in a while. But stuff that I knew that I loved. And it'd be nice to hear that song again. It'd be nice to, you know, so that was... I'm a Man You Don't Meet Every Day, again, is one of those.
This joke's your time, a canny gunman and a roving young fella I've been. So easy and free when you drink, and when me, I'm a man you don't meet every day.
Beautiful, you know. That one leads us on to this one, and Macy Gray. And the song I would like to, there's two, I Try on side one there. And the story behind this one is, I was in a relationship for 15 years, and I had 3 children, and I separated from their mother. And I think we come from the first generation that has experienced divorce. So it's going to take a generation or two, I think, for people to know what divorce is and to know the consequences of divorce and to know how to handle divorce, you know? Like our parents, so would have stuck together come hell or high water. They're like, you know, living in spite of each other, you know, like a lot of us would have grown up in quite, you know, but there was amazing resilience there as well. Those people got married and just said that was what they did. They stayed married. When we came of an age to get married and divorce and separated and all that type of stuff, it was kind of like, okay, we have this option of not being together if we don't want to be. But I don't think that we were very experienced. We had no experience of it. Even though, historically speaking, when you read old Irish mythology, you know, Cuchulainn and Ferdia and all these people, divorce and separation was a natural thing. People were often reared with stepmothers and stepfathers, and they were fostered out here and there. But for the past maybe 400 or 500 years, that wasn't the way things worked in Ireland. So it takes time to be able to learn how to do something. And one of the big difficulties, the main difficulty really in a situation like that, for the person who is living away from the children, is getting used to that. Is trying to not living in the same house as your children is difficult, and it takes time to learn how to do it for yourself and for the kids. And this song, again, this is just a big crybaby session, lads. This is another emotional heart wrecker. So this is the song that whenever it came on the radio, I think one of my kids might have even played it in the car. For some reason, just struck a chord with me in that thing of trying to be a dad and try to feel that emotional closeness with your children when you weren't living in the same house as them.
Great track.
Yeah, it's fantastic. Yeah.
I noticed in the lyrics here that I thought it was I keep my cool, but I'm feeling, I thought, is always what I thought she sang. It's actually I'm fiending, which here in Cork, kind of goes, she's fiending. So that's for all the fiends.
Yeah, beautiful. Yeah, what a voice. Again, another unorthodox voice, you know. But beautiful, you know. And I've seen her been interviewed a few times. I was on one of those MTV crib things around her house, you know, and it's mental. Like, she's a Black Jacks. Like, her toilet is, it's black. Like, the whole room is black. The Black Jacks, black walls, everything's black. It's fucking brilliant. But she's eccentric. She's a big, huge kind of afro head of kind of, and she's a tall woman as well. She's in a movie I saw recently, actually, and she actually talks. She kind of talks. You're out there, no way. So she's marvelously eccentric. But there's something, you know, in all that eccentricity and peculiarity and idiosyncrasy, there's something so authentic about her. You know, she'd blow me away. She's brilliant.
Do we have another from this, or do we want
to... We've still from this album as well, which I can't remember how it goes, but I know I love it. I'll know it as soon as it starts.
Messed up, and he knows just what to say. No more dawn and new days.
That's one of those songs where if you're listening to it on your own as a man, you're kind of it's that great transgender part of a man's imagination where for 4 minutes and 22 seconds he just imagines what it might be like to be a woman. But the beats in that and are fantastic. She's an amazing creature.
It was a wonderful album. It was huge at the time. 1999 is the year on this one, and yeah. She never quite came. She maybe didn't want to come back. Sometimes I think artists maybe get a taste of that big thing and go, "Ooh, I don't know."
Sure,
if I...
yeah. And sometimes they earn enough money from one album just to do whatever they want.
But it was, that was a much played album back then.
Yeah. So finally, we have. It's impossible to grow up in Ireland and listening to Irish music and not have some opinion on U2. I like this album mostly because I think of the chances that U2 took on it. So it seems to me, and this is only as an outsider, and I might be way wrong, it seems to me that U2 put themselves under tremendous pressure to be successful and to be the best. And that, I think, is a kind of a constricting way of looking at things. I think that you probably are more creative when you commit to taking chances and you commit to having an adventure, wherever that might lead you. Bob Dylan is a great inspiration in terms of that. You know, he just, Bob Dylan doesn't try and please a certain part of the market. He just, I feel like releasing this now, seems to be his attitude. And Don't Forget About Fire by U2, to me, is the album where they took the most chances. It seems to me after this album, the album they made after this was The Joshua Tree, which was so commercial and so fantastic and such great pop songs on it. But this was the one I thought where they're onto something here. They're onto something. Now, if they'd have followed this road, they might have ended up like an Irish Radiohead, and that's maybe not the road they wanted to go down. But this one is, it's probably my favorite album of all time. It doesn't make a fierce amount of sense. There's no, I went down to the shops and bought a dog and then I shot myself. The lyrics aren't as
understandable. But he was almost reaching for something almost untangible, wasn't he?
Yeah.
What's the year on that? Because I remember listening to Fanning.
Oh, this is 84, 85, I think.
Yeah, so when was Joshua Tree? Was that,
Joshua Tree would have been 80... Joshua was 86 or 87.
Yes. Sorry, yeah. I was listening to Fanning on New Year's Eve. It was 1989, and they played a series of gigs up to New Year's Eve, and he just finished on stage. I was wondering, was Joshua Tree after or before, but he finished saying, "We're going away to dream it all up again." Yeah. And then they came back with the pop and the whole kind of different thing.
Yeah.
That did mark a point between them. But this led to the Joshua Tree.
Yeah, it did. But to me, this is a more interesting album because I think there's... and with Song Bad, I read an interview with Bono recently where he said, you know, I never finished that song properly. And to me, it's the fact that it's open is what makes it so brilliant. And I think the other song I chose was A Sort of Homecoming.
Both of which featured on the live, the Wide Awake in America.
I think
they released four songs live, well worth listening to too.
They're fantastic. I mean, they don't make a fierce amount of sense, but there's something creative in them and wonderful.
Well, the bad one was one that really meant a lot to me too, or certainly as a song. It'd be hard not to be captivated by it. Particularly, it was the 80s in Ireland was not really a great time. Dublin was rife with a heroin epidemic, and that's what that song was kind of about. I see seven towers and I only see one way out, and it was.
There was no heroin in Navan now.
Then, sadly, probably now.
Yeah, the big drug in Navan, the outlaw drug in Navan, when I was growing up, was snake bites. Do you remember snake bites? The thing was cider and lager, and you'd inject that. So. Flavor of it, but that's the type of stuff, you know, it's great.
Ambition is what strikes me about U2. They just had a real desire to go further, and they did.
Ambition on its own is ugly, you know. It depends what the ambition is for. If the ambition is just for success, it's thin, then it's unpleasant to be around. If the ambition is for the heart and communication and fun, then I think that's rewarding, and that's very pleasing to be around and to experience, you know. So there are a lot of thinly ambitious people, and sometimes thin ambition gets a hold of decent people. But there are moments when an open heart and a wide mind collide, and they're the best ones to be around and to experience, you know.
I think Bono and arguably the band wanted a connection, and you know, I used to love the things they did. It meant, it seemed to mean something, you know, where he's climbing up in gantries with white flags, and loads of. But it, you know, someone doing something, someone sort of.
Yeah, and things change, and just because a band achieved that when they're young doesn't mean they live there for the rest of their careers, any more than any artist does, you know. But that moment, I thought was brilliant, profound, you know.
They don't scrimp on the bits that they give you, but just one element that it says here about 1984 being a funny old year, nothing like George Orwell had imagined. Bishop Tutu won the Nobel Prize, and the first Apple Macintosh went on sale. So that kind of, you know, when we look at now, how the world has changed with technology.
You know, it's funny. One thing I think is different about listening to music, and I know my children's interest in music is profound. And they know the lyrics to songs, and they have a wide range in tastes and stuff like that. And they're just as informed about music as we were when we were growing up, you know. The one big difference, I think, is that when I was growing up in the mid-80s, it was okay to like trad. There was a guy called Davey Spillane, who used to play with Moving Hearts. He was an Illan pipe player. And he released an album, Moving Hearts released an album called The Storm. And when I moved to Galway, I remember it being an okay thing to do, to go drinking and go drinking in a trad pub and listen to tunes all evening. And that's the only difference I'd say between now and then is the Irish traditional music had a bit more. And what Irish traditional music then, what that led to, that kind of informed the Pogues a little bit. That kind of informed the Waterboys a little bit. So I think that's kind of absent now. I mean, something else has taken its place, you know, but that's the one difference. I think the kids maybe aren't as interested in folk music and wild Illan pipe playing as maybe our generation were, you know. And no harm, things change. But that's the only identifiable difference I can kind of spot.
You know? Well, I remember Mike Scott went and lived over in Galway for a while and made an album over there. And it, you know, for me as a youngster in Dundalk at that time, kind of, I didn't really want to go to Dublin. The North still had all of the North stuff that I didn't really want to have to deal with. Mm-hmm. And I was kind of like, there must be somewhere else in Ireland. So Galway had this kind of bit of a buzz about it. I think it was to do with those things and that kind of sense of the West's awake and this, that, and the other. Now, I didn't end up in Galway. I ended up here. But I was delighted when I got here to find that, yes, there is other places than Dublin in the country that have a huge sense of themselves and a sense of pride and a deserving sense of pride. So the minute I came down here, I went, this is great.
I remember once being in Easton's in Galway and standing beside Joe Wall, who was the bass player with The Stunning, and thinking, this is as exciting as my life gets. Like, this is... Because the two bands came out of Galway around then, The Saw Doctors and The Stunning, and they were legends. And Joe Wall was just the coolest motherfucker that ever strode down a street. And to be standing beside him at Easton's was, I mean, seeing Mike Scott on his High Nelly cycling over Bridge, down Bridge Street and down towards Dominic Street was incredible. But Joe Wall, I mean...
Stunning.
And living legend.
And Machnas were a thing back. There was just a real vibe there. Over in Galway.
Yeah, and all of that creativity was fueled by the dole. I swear to God, none of that would have been possible without the 32 quid a week you were getting and your £10 rent allowance. None of it would have been possible. You know? So it was this kind of a state-sponsored nothingness. And there was... Could have been 25,000 of us living that life in Galway at the time, doing fuck all. And it was fantastic. And you're right, Machnas came out of that. All the great rock and roll came out of that. I came out of that, you know. Now, for some people, they went the other way. A good friend of mine is a drug dealer and in prison. So it didn't turn out great for everybody. there were great days. And I'm still in Galway. I'm in Galway over 30 years now. Yeah, that's it. And my kids, I have 6 children, and each of them, the older ones especially, they love Galway as well, and they have the thing where going away is nice, but coming back is even nicer, you know. So,
do you want to take one last one from this, or will we? We do have one more song to play, but would you like to take another one?
No, I think we'll skip it because people got a flavour of that, I think, from that. But we've one more. Is it the Christmas one?
It's the Christmas one. We'll just ahead of that. Yeah. Thanks so much for doing
this. My pleasure. I hope I didn't bore people now with my musical choices.
We do. Thank you, Tommy Tiernan. Thank you very much. We do have one more pair of tickets to give away. Do you have a question, maybe? I was going to ask a question based on some of the stuff that you said, but would you have anything you'd like to do? Or?
So my question would be for a pair of free tickets to the Marquee. Name one other act that's also playing at the Marquee next year. Now, she put up her hand first, but the lady said David Gray first. So why don't we give the lady in the front the tickets, and I'll put the lady who said David Gray on the guest list.
Oh, isn't that fantastic? There you go. And this is a lady who does fantastic work for the Penny Dinners here in Cork.
Oh, great, great. So the lady who said David Gray, where was she? I'll get your name before we go, and I'll give you, and the lady behind you in the hat, you can have two guest tickets as well, so there's four guest tickets. If you give me your names after the show, and I'll put you
on. That's Kate from Red FM. I'm sure we could probably get her in anyway.
And I'll tell you what, I'll give a free guest ticket to everybody in the audience. Hey! How about that? So if you all give me your names, I'll give you, because there's so many of you, I can only give you one each, apart from the two ladies here. But if you want, I'll put you on the guest list for the Marquee. It'd be my pleasure.
That's absolutely fantastic. Thanks so much.
My pleasure. Only 3,967 tickets left to sell.